Sitting up there, we're probably going to rise and welcome you.
Welcome, everyone. It's good to be with you all here in person, as well as those of you who are following us through the live stream online. This is our new normal. Remember a year and a half ago when we kept wondering when the new normal would be? Guess what? Here we are, but it's good to be with everyone. I want to just reinforce the fact that we're trying to make absolutely certain that we keep our physical distance. So in case you're wondering why I don't go amongst you and do the usual schmoozing, that's why, because I want to try and set a good example so that we observe the physical distancing, because when we are inside for any length of time, we do increase the risk of any possibility of transmission of the virus. So we're trying to be very careful about that indeed. I want to say some thank yous to David Hamilton and the Kincardine United Church Choir, those that are able to be here this morning, who, as you may have noticed, for those who were here in person, were rehearsing this morning, physically distant, as you can see behind me. And thank you to David, because he's dealing with an organ that still is giving him fits and starts. And so, in fact, just a month ago, his hair was jet black. However, thank you to Sarah McKenzie for putting the slide presentation together, to Jim and Judy Zerubik, who are up in the balcony making sure all the technology works well so that I sound okay and the visuals are being done appropriately, to Stu and Donna Mowry, who are our greeters this morning. There's a whole lot of extra stuff to do because of the Sacrament of Communion, so thank you to Stu and Donna. To John Phillips and John Brash, who take care of the finances of the congregation. Obviously, we use the screens a lot, so whenever it's red, print, and bold, that's for the worship leader to read, in this case, myself, or there will be a few others later on in the service. And the black print and bold is for everyone to read together, and we're still adjusting to how that works best. Because now that we have you folks here in person, it used to be that Judy in the balcony would lead you off with the red, with the black print in bold, but we're adjudicating how that works because we keep hearing the choir, and it almost sounds like it's, well, an echo chorus. So we'll see how that works out. Let's practice that then as we acknowledge the territory on which we are privileged to gather. Kincardine United Church takes seriously the commitments made to First Nations communities through the National Truth and Reconciliation Commission report, especially through the calls to action to churches like us. There are a few announcements that I'd like to bring to your attention. There's one that just came in this morning. Thank you, Catherine. Catherine, and I'm going to paraphrase it because you don't need all the details that are in this, but she is most appreciative for all who contributed to and made the work happen so that we have the automatic door openers to get into the church, particularly the ramp door here. It makes a huge difference, and she is very, very grateful. So thank you, Catherine, for that, but also thank you to everyone who made that happen. I know that the property ministry was hugely involved in that in the administration committee and making sure the funds were available, so thank you. There are going to be new church office hours as of October 12th. Why October 12th? We'll just wait for the next slide and you'll find out. But when the church office reopens, they will be from 1:30 till 5 o'clock, Tuesday through Friday in the afternoon. So the reason it is October the 12th, if we could go to the next slide, the booking of the facility will begin as of October the 12th. And in order to book the facility, whether that is for groups that are not part and parcel of our community of faith, or for groups that are, for example, even the choir has to book it, don't they, David? go through our booking facilitators through the church website. And so that on October the 12th, that's the first time that we will gradually ease into opening the building for those people who book it. And therefore, the office door will be open on those office hours, but not beyond those hours. As well, Emily did it again. Now, you knew she would. She's an insistent and persistent individual. Notice that her hair was mostly gone. This is to raise funds for the Terry Fox run. Since Emily, as she says, you know, I'm not going to be running around town, so this is the best way for me to raise money for the Terry Fox Fund. So if you wish to do so, feel free to go to the Terry Fox Foundation online and follow the prompts. And she thanks you very much for your support. Also, there will be a new study group starting up. It will be online, and there will be a link for the Zoom meeting for that. It is a 90-minute session, 7 o'clock on Thursday nights, beginning on October 14th, and it is based on Embracing a Life of Meaning, which is best-selling author Kathleen Norris's perspective on what matters most in life. You notice the titles are Belief Matters, The Bible Matters, Community Matters, Place Matters, and We Matter. As well, on the end of the month, well, almost the end, because actually there's 5 Sundays in October, on the second last Sunday of October, on the 24th at 7 o'clock, there will be a service of prayers for, with the music of Taze. It's a deeply contemplative service that I have found really centers me in the heart of God. So feel free to join us for that, whether in person or online. As the church has done for millennia, we always greet each other. So I greet you. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
So don't move, but look around and kind of raise an eyebrow or go, peace, or go like this, hey, how you doing? And if you're online, hey, peace of Christ be with you. Oh, well, good, okay. Because we know that God is with us, among us, and surrounds us at all times and all places, let's pay attention to that as we prepare for worship. The light of Christ shines among us and within us, guiding us along our way. Let's join together in the call to worship and prayer of approach that you'll find on your screens. Come into this safe space, whether digitally or in person, welcomed by God who perceives each of us as worthy.
We come eagerly and with anticipation, committed to creating a faith community of welcome and of inclusion.
Come into this building, which has been locked up for too long, to realize that this church was never closed, but planted soul deep.
We come to celebrate our faith alive, empowered by the Spirit's strength.
Come then, as we join our hearts in prayer as one in God's heart.
There are some of us here who worship in person of God, along with many of us digitally connected from our homes. Yet even across those obvious divides, you call us to be one. Crack open our hearts to empathize with those who choose differently. Break open our judgments to embrace one another with compassion. Fracture our preconceptions to open our minds to understanding. Transform our self-righteousness into insight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And let's join together in our first hymn, We Praise You, O God, number 218 in Voices United.
The sacrament of communion is one of the central practices of our faith.
Communion is a sign act which proclaims unconditional welcome and our becoming a community which is united in the risen Christ.
Jesus' invitation to this table is a gift of reckless love of which we are a part.
These quilted additions to our communion table declare our coming together as a community of faith, gathered, upheld, and sent out by our gracious God.
We are one in fabric, in design, in talent, and in faith. These quilts represent our coming together as one, Through fabric donated by many in this family of faith, crafted lovingly and skillfully. By Elaine Holmes, Shirley Marie Harris, Esther Marshall, Janet Palmateer, and which are now part of our collective worship life. We are one, and these quilted gifts are concrete symbols of our becoming. Bless these gifts, O God, by the power of your Spirit, and in Jesus' name, that they may perceive your love within and around us in this fabric. May we know your grace each day as you sew us into your heart. In response to God's blessing through loving grace, may we open our hearts to God in silent prayer for renewal and for new life. Amen. So I know it's a terrible pun to see a title for the sharing time as So What, spelled with an F-E-W. But it is, after all, just after the dedication of these quilt runners. Now, just to remind everyone so that you know, the fabric that is comprising these quilts came from people throughout the congregation. I know because I drove around to a number of places to pick things up. There were others who dropped it off at Elaine's place, still others who brought their own, you know, particularly the four who were busy crafting these quilts. And this is the problem when you allow your minister to go away on study leave. See, I went online and I was part of a preaching symposium that went over 5 days. And one of the worship services was using quilting as the theme that pulled the worship together. And in my mind, a light bulb went off, and I thought, what if, because this was back in May this year, I was really hoping that we'd be back this fall to some form of in-person worship. And wouldn't it be wonderful to have this kind of symbol as part of our coming back together, a recognition that the church was never really closed, because this is where the church is. This is where the church is. This is where the church is, all out in the community, with every one of you there online watching us live streaming. This is where the church is. And God is the stitchery that pulls us together. The Holy Spirit wields a sharp and precise needle to bring us together, to sew us into one. And all of these fabrics, and I know I'm making it hard on poor Judy as I move around. Sorry, Judy. All of these fabrics that are on here came from people in the congregation, but that's not all. You see that? You see? It's two-sided. Hoo-hoo! And you know what else? You may not be able to see this online, and you can't see it further back, but the stitching is so precise that I can't see any of the mess that I would see if I was quilting. So thank you to the four of you who did all of the work. It is an amazing piece of faithful symbolism. Elaine Holmes is the one that pulled it all together, and it actually arose out of me sitting in on the back patio, physically distant and masked with Rod Coates. We were chatting about stuff, and I said, you know, I have this idea, and I'm not sure how to put it together. And I don't know how many of you know, but his wife, Mary, happens to be a quilter of much renown and skill. And so she got called out of the house to converse with us. And then I asked around in the congregation, and who is it that is really into this and might be willing to take it on? And Elaine's name came up. And so I went to visit her, again, physically distanced on her patio outside with mask on, and she very graciously said, sure, I'll be happy to coordinate it. And believe it or not, because, you know, it is the church, she did so with enthusiasm, with vigor, with vision, and with skill. So I want to thank you particularly, Elaine, because you made it all come into fruition. Thank you. Knowing that we are all connected in God's heart, God's Spirit stitches us all together. Let's use the words that Jesus gave us to stitch us further still as one. Let us sing.
Our Father,
our Bible reading this morning is from Psalm 26, and from the paraphrase, The Message. Vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity, and I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and mind, for your steadfast love is before my eyes, and I walk in faithfulness to you. I do not sit with the worthless, nor do I consort with hypocrites. I hate the company of evildoers, and I will not sit with the wicked. I wash my hands in innocence, and I go around your altar, O Lord, singing aloud a song of thanksgiving and telling all of your wondrous deeds. O Lord, I love the house in which you dwell, and the place where your glory abides. Do not sweep me away with sinners, nor my life with the bloodthirsty, those in whose hands are evil devices, and whose right hands are full of bribes. But as for me, I walk in my integrity. Redeem me and be gracious to me. My foot stands on level ground. In the great congregation, I will bless the Lord. Let's sing together, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus, Voices United, number 357. Our second Bible reading this morning is from Mark chapter 10, verses 13 to 16. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly, I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them.
Together in prayer. Loving God, in this time of pandemic, we have been locked down. Sometimes we felt like we've been locked up. And certainly we have become more isolated, more cautious. Crack us open, O God, so that we may know your presence is always here, even when we feel alone or lonely, even when we feel abandoned, wondering. May your spirit so move and blow among us that we open like a flower in the spring. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. So if you may have remembered what Judy read from the psalm this morning, it sounds pretty arrogant to me. Anybody get that feeling? Oh, there's some of you online got that as well, I see. but the reality is, it sounds like the person writing the psalm is strutting around going, "Well, you know, I'm not like some of you lot. I'm good. I don't mess around with people like you, Shirley. You've been places and done things, you know. I've never done that. I am pure and holy. I never go faster than the speed limit. I always stop precisely on the line for the stop signs. Even when I'm going to turn, I make sure that there's no one in the way, no pedestrians, no dogs, no turtles. I am so good. Can't you just see that I stink of goodness? Isn't that wonderful? Don't you want to be like me? Surely you do. I know you do. I can see you smiling. Yes. And if you were like me, your halo would be as white as your hair. It would. It would be so lovely. Why, even those up there in the balcony would be envious of me because I don't associate with the people from the wrong side of the tracks. You know, I don't want to be corrupted. Yes, Wayne, that means you. That's right, you know. I mean, anybody who works at Home Hardware, come on, man. I'm telling you, but I like the fact that you clean up everyone else's mess. So, you know, there's some hope for you yet, but still, you're not as good as me. That's why I get to wear this. That's why I'm in this position as the minister of this congregation, because I'm just perfect. You know why ministers have collars? Well, for most of them, it's because their halos have slipped. Notice, I don't wear a collar. Oh, you laugh. But you just wait until you're dead. Then you'll be sorry. And I heard the choir practicing an anthem I'm looking forward to in the future, and it says, "We are not alone." Well, you know, when you die, you're not going to be alone. But I will. I'll be there with good old St. Peter. We'll be trading terrible puns, but they'll be good ones. Right? See how wonderful it is to be perfect? Except the world isn't perfect. I was reading the newspaper yesterday, procrastinating on finishing off my sermon, quite frankly, and I read this article about a young woman by the name of Roya Shams. She was a citizen of Afghanistan. And at 15 years of age, she left Afghanistan to come to Canada. She was the youngest of 9 children and had spent all of her life to that point sleeping beside her 5 sisters, her 4 sisters. There were 5 daughters. And her dad was a police colonel, and he was someone who worked very closely and diligently with Canadian forces in Afghanistan when our forces were over there. And he was murdered by the Taliban, and they set her school on fire. She was terrified. And in her mind, the Taliban were exactly what I portrayed from Psalm 26, you know. They had the right perspective on life. And because everyone else was soiled, if they didn't follow that perspective, it was all right to get rid of them by killing them. And don't get me wrong, there's an awful lot of Christians who've had that same view. Maybe rooted in something like Psalm 26. After her dad was murdered, she remembered that her dad had insisted on education for all of his children, particularly his 5 daughters. And he was pivotal in the more liberal viewpoint than the one that was touted by the Taliban interpretation of the Quran and of Islam. The children, like their father, were open-minded, believing women should be as free as men. Roya's older sister had written in an Afghan medical journal about options for women having trouble conceiving. Usual Afghan practice was to take a new wife. Anybody here tried that? Oh, good, good. Roya's sister wrote in this journal that there were other options that should be explored first. Her paper had put a big target on her back because it supposedly dishonored her family. Roya made it safely to Canada, achieving her undergrad degree, and is now a graduate student in Ottawa. But she was so missing her family and worried at the increasing danger for all of them because of their liberal viewpoints. Indeed, Roya's brother, a medical student at 19, said the Taliban won't allow anyone to study in English, and he wanted to be able to do medicine around the world. So why am I bringing that up? The whole idea is that the Taliban's perspective was that you had to have a singular point of view, that there was no way that there could be a multiplicity of viewpoints, so that there could be conversation and dialogue and discussion, a kind of a push-pull if you will, which is the whole fabric of what I would consider is a healthy community of faith. I sure don't want everyone who's watching this online or everyone who's here in person to believe the same thing that I do. That would be really boring for me and probably misguided, as David knows probably better than anybody having to work with me. But if we look at the story from Mark's gospel, it's a simple, well-known story. It's the story of the children coming. And now, they were brought with their parents. At the time of Jesus, children were seen as possessions. They didn't have any specific agency. They were merely ciphers until they got old enough for their bar mitzvah or their bat mitzvah, because child mortality was so incredibly high in those days that why invest too much of your heart in your children if they're just going to die on you anyway? Save yourself the pain. And so when their parents brought the children with them, and why wouldn't they? They didn't have daycare centers in those days, and the parents wanted to hear what Jesus had to say. Jesus invited the children to come. And there were his disciples, you know, kind of the gatekeepers, and they were going, no. No, you don't want to have the children come. What's the good of children? They're not important at all. It's the adults you want to meet with. It's the adults you want to tell about the kingdom of God. Not recognizing in their own attitude that that was completely opposite to what Jesus' teaching was about the reign of God here and now, about loving one another, about loving kindness, about compassion, about serving each other, about self-giving in love for one another. Isn't that what you do with children? Isn't that how you try and raise them? You show them the same sort of thing, that love is at the center of it all. And so chastened, the disciples backed away, and the kids flowed up on Jesus' lap, and he interacted with them. It doesn't say anything except that he laid hands on them. I have no idea what that means. I'm willing to bet some of them were giving him a hug, and some of them were tugging on his hair, and others were picking at his toenails because, you know, they'd be sticking under the sandals. You know how kids do things like that. There'd be some little kid behind him that would be taking his robe and probably wiping a runny nose on it so that no one could notice. Anybody ever experienced that when they were children? Yes, that was the message that Jesus was trying to get across. He was trying to crack open this self-righteousness to find the humanity within, to prick that bubble of arrogance. Roya Shams, when the Taliban were starting to take over some of the provinces in Afghanistan earlier this year, in February actually, started to get very worried. She made a list of the family that she knew were in danger, not the ones that had moved to Sweden or Australia or to the United States. She felt that they were relatively safe. But there were 27 members of her family that she desperately wanted to rescue. She wanted to be able to reunite with them, to give them the same gift that they had given her when she was but a 15-year-old teenage girl. An opportunity to escape the strictures of a society that was so tightly bound that it allowed no light to enter in. And so she started working with people all over the country. She connected with a group called the Veterans Transition Network, a series of an organization of Canadian veterans of the Afghanistan War, who were trying to get the interpreters who aided them, the people who worked in the offices over there for them, to get over to Canada so they would be safe from the Taliban retribution. She also worked with other veteran organizations like the MN Lara, which provided safe houses and food in Kabul. Now, She filled out 257 government forms on behalf of her family. And those 27 members of her family were in a safe house with food supplied. She even managed to get in touch with Lisa LaFlamme. Anybody ever heard of the main anchor of the CTV news cast at 11 o'clock on weeknights? And Lisa LaFlamme, with her husband, who's also a journalist, worked with all of these organizations to try and bring the family over. Here's the rub. The Kandahar airport, you remember how many people were gathered around, desperate to get in? The five people who fell from an American transport plane to their deaths because they were that desperate to fly out? In the safe house, they would get an email from the Canadian government saying, okay, follow these instructions and we should be able to get you out. None of them could. So instead, all 27 members of the family escaped over land. Now, I have no idea what that was like. The article didn't talk about it, but I can only imagine the fear, the worry, the terror of being caught and killed. They arrived in Canada at Pearson Airport just a week ago. And as they trickled out through the arrivals gate, suddenly Roya saw her mother, who was being wheeled out in a wheelchair. Her mother, that she hadn't seen for 10 years. And she fell on her knees. And they held one another. And despite the physical distancing limitations, 27 people became a cloud of love, of relief, of release. And it wouldn't have happened without all of the people working together. Regardless of their perspective on what was right or wrong, regardless of whether they felt 27 was far too many, regardless of whether they thought a 25-year-old a graduate student in Ottawa had any right in asking for that many people to come over, regardless of the so-called concerns about all of these migrants taking our jobs away, regardless of the worries about the pandemic and the economic circumstances in which we live, regardless of all of those worries and concerns, they are here. And it wasn't perfect. And it wasn't out of self-righteousness. It was out of love. Because just like the children sitting on Jesus' knee, Jesus cracks open our hearts every day to show us the way of love everywhere. I pray that it may be so for each of us, each moment, each day. Amen. This table is for everyone, a table of new light and of generous welcome.
To this,
this table we bring our fears and our dreaming. The risen Christ invites the whole human race to become light and love. With hundreds of millions of our siblings worldwide, we are gathered by God's invitation in all our diversity and in all our difference. The call to this table is for each person, doubtful or certain, broken or whole, stranger or friend, neighbor or foe. No one is barred. All are welcome to be nourished in Christ's name. May God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give God our thanks and our praise.
It is right to give God our thanks and our praise.
God's reign among and within us has been as pervasive as a weed, a mustard seed of profound persistence. When God spoke and creation was called into being, the intricate web of life was woven with interdependence and in connection.
When
God commanded Abraham and Sarah to venture far from home, they became rooted in their growing identity as people of the way. When God challenged Moses to liberate a people from oppression, Miriam danced in joyful celebration as they began their journey of becoming.
When royals and rulers sought power over people,
instead of following God's challenge to serve people, like stubborn weeds, God planted prophets to disrupt their control. Yet still, we did not listen. In response, Jesus came to live with, among, and beside us, showing us the reign of God is not in some heaven light years away. God's reign is here and now, within and among us.
Though
the unfolding of our lives is a mystery, all of us long for wholeness. We are the old and the young. We are the rich and the haughty. We are the meek and the humble. We are the proud and the strong. We are the blind and the lame. Yet we are God's own together. In our belonging, we find home in the living hope of the risen Christ. We know, O God, how profoundly and unconditionally you love each one of us. You even love us collectively as this community of faith. Because you love us, we know we are made to love others in return. in our love. Hear the silent prayers of our hearts, for ourselves and for all our struggles, for others we know who need your guidance, for a world that wrestles with the environmental emergency, with war and conflict, with authoritarian governments, with racism and misogyny, with income disparity, with poverty, and with refugee migration. Hear our prayers, O God, and in your love, listen. Thank you, Living Spirit, for your healing and your encouragement.
Through our communion in prayer,
may we find the courage to turn the world upside down. May we foster a sense of community rooted in love, the same love Jesus gave freely at his table. Amen. And so it was on the night in which he was betrayed that Jesus took the bread, and after he had given thanks, he blessed it and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he poured it out. And he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood. Whenever you drink of it, remember me."
Living Spirit, bless our gathering
around this table of radical inclusion, equipping us once again to be salt for the earth. When we eat this bread broken, may we find our brokenness healed. As we drink the grape juice poured out, may we be poured out through compassion for and with all people. Nourish us by this sacrament, that we may be holy and true. Amen. Now, you've all received a self-contained, prepared, hermetically sealed grape juice shot glass with a soft wafer. So here are the instructions, because we've never used these before, so we have to learn. You'll notice that there's a little tab on one side. Just peel that up, and you'll see the whole lid disappears and comes apart. Now you're wondering where the bread is. If you take a look at the tab on the top, there is another tab, and all you do is you peel away that plastic top, and there is a wafer. Now, some of you who got the gluten-free crackers, it's a whole lot easier. You just have to take the cellophane off and you're good. I would invite you to take, if you're at home, whatever you have prepared for this communion, feel free to consume it now. For those of you that are here, feel free to consume the elements that you have. I know it feels a little strange to have to take the mask aside, eat, and then put it back on again, but thank you everyone for keeping each other safe. Let us join together in prayer once more.
We have received the gift of grace at your table, O Christ. Take what we have said and done here, planting it like a weed in our hearts. May your mustard seed of love so persist within us that we become evermore a people in service for your reign, O God. May you breathe into our souls, O Spirit, a persistent passion to do your will with our siblings worldwide. Amen. Just have to find my script. There we are. On this Sunday, as we celebrate the Sacrament of Communion along with hundreds of millions of Christians around the world, we know the profound strength of the body of Christ worldwide. For example, when emergencies strike, people need help right away. First, with the basics: shelter, food, clothing. And then with rebuilding, increasingly, people around the world are facing a variety of disasters, like climate change, or health crises, or food insecurity, and violent conflicts that forcibly displace thousands of people, who are just some of the catastrophes that affect millions of people each day. The United Church is part of a worldwide network that makes a difference in the lives of those most at risk. United Church partners in ecumenical relationships in over 120 countries mean that we are on the ground ready to help in times of emergencies. Recently, generous supporters have helped people struggling as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, survivors of the devastating explosion in Beirut, and the earthquake in Haiti. From vaccines to hygiene kits and from food to farm implements, your support is there when needed most. In return, our partners minister to us in a variety of ways, including spiritually. The United Church of Christ in the Philippines, one of our mission and service partners, shares this prayer with us. Let us pray together. Most gracious and merciful God, amidst the din of howling winds, above the noise of rampaging waves, atop the earthquakes and the shaking of the earth, we hear your voice. Be still and know that I am God. Yes, even in times when we are prone not to be still, at moments when we are sorely tempted to resort to flight, we hear you, and we pause to listen and to reflect, to stand still and recognize that indeed you are the God who is with us, that we are not alone. In times like these, you speak to reassure us through that still small voice, through the concrete acts of solidarity of partners and friends, through those who lovingly stretched out their helping hands, to those ravaged by the storm, to those who are desolate and in despair, to those who are left with a threadbare of hope. In times like these, you assure us that we are not alone. So to you we return all glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. However you give to Kincardine United Church, whether it's by pre-authorized remittance or whether you've dropped something in the offering plate at the back of the sanctuary, or you will on your way out, or if you use our online methodology to give to the church, thank you. You truly do make a difference. So let us ask for God's blessing on all that we give of our time, our talent, and our treasure. We bring
you, risen Christ, our offerings. We dedicate these, our offerings of time, of talent, and of treasure, praying that, by your blessing, these gifts may be adopted as your children of the way, transforming the world by making a loving difference. May you bless us in our giving, that we too continue to help bring the world to greater wholeness. Amen. Well, let's join together in the final hymn, number 556 in Voices United. Would you bless our homes and families? Now go, as a people gathered by the sender of love, upheld by the one who came in love, sent out in the power of love. Go in peace.